All right, good morning.
Good morning and welcome back. I have been waiting a long time to say that we are delighted to be able to reopen our facility and have people actually in the room worshiping with us today. You know, it was March 15th of 2020 that we had our last worship service here at Hope. We did a few in our backyard. We did do two services in this room in November. And then we're very quickly closed down again because of health concerns, and we understand that. About 2 weeks ago, the United States Supreme Court made a decision. They said churches can reopen. And an hour and a half after that, Santa Clara County said that does not apply to Santa Clara County. And so we were shut down again. 2 days later, the Supreme Court said, yes, Santa Clara County, it applies to you. It has been a very tenuous, difficult time. And so because of that, we are so delighted again to be able to welcome you and to have you here on site. So we have people here in our room. We have people outside. We have, as we have promised to do, people still doing part of our live stream. And we're going to continue to do that into the future. I have a friend that came up to me about a month or so ago, and He said, "Kevin, how's the ministry going?" And my answer to him was, "You know, it's really tough being in the people business when you can't be with people." And that kind of, I think, is a description of this last year for so many of us. But one thing that we learned in this last year, the church is not the building. The church is the people of God. And the church is we who are scattered into this world to be the light of Jesus Christ to so many. But again, we're excited, we're delighted, so very happy that we can come back together in this place today. But in our gathering, there's a little bit of a sorrow, if I can put it that way, in our gathering. A man by the name of Tom Rainier. He's probably one of the leading authorities on the church in America today. He's the CEO of a ministry called Lifeway. Some of you may be familiar with Lifeway. They own Christian bookstores all over the nation, all over the world, really. But they do so much more. They do church consulting. They do church planting. They do leadership development. But Mr. Rainier is an expert on the church. And this last week, he made a statement. He said that more than 9,000 churches in America have closed this last year and will not reopen because of COVID. You may recall about a year and a half ago, we were thinking that Hope might have to close. And during this last year, God has been more than faithful. God has sustained us, He has provided, and it's the people of Hope that have kept us alive, and we trust as they have listened to the leading of the Spirit. And so today there's a little bit more of a joy, if you will, and an excitement in gathering back together. And I just wanted to let you know how very thankful we are for the people of Hope, for your faithfulness, for your prayer, for your giving, just for your being part of this household of faith. And so I don't want us to take this regathering, this new start for us, to take that lightly. But to obviously give credit where credit is due. And that completely goes to the Lord. And so I thought the very best thing that we could do as we restart, as we gather together, is just to spend a moment in prayer thanking Him for what He has done. So would you pray with me? And Father, first of all, we are so grateful for your hand of provision, for the way that you have watched over and sustained our ministry this last year. There were times, even in this year, where we were not sure what would be next. But God, you are sovereign. You are the head of this church, and we are so thankful for what you have done. And so this morning, as we gather here in this place once again, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for being the head of this church, for leading us, for guiding us, for directing us, and again, for providing and sustaining. Lord, we love you, we praise you, and we trust that all that takes place here this morning would be pleasing to you, equipping and encouraging for your children, both here and online. And Lord, that what we do would matter. We know that Christ came into this world so that we could have life and life eternal with you. And what we do today in the proclamation of that truth leads us and many others to that end. So again, thank you. We want to praise you. We, again, just want to tell you that we love you. And Father, we would ask that you would receive now.
It's the song of the redeemed, rising from the African plain. It's the song of the forgiven, drowning out the Amazon rain. The song of tribe, every tongue, every nation, a love song born of a grateful choir. It's a good children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. It's a good children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, He reigns, He reigns. Above the four winds, caught up in the heavenly sound. Let praises echo from the towers of cathedrals to the faithful gathered underground. Of all the songs sung from the dark. somewhere meant to persist. Of all the bells rung from a thousand steeples, none rings truer than this. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. It's all God's children singing glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. And all the powers of darkness tremble at what they've just heard. Cause all the powers of darkness can't drown out a single word. When all God's children sing of glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. All God's children sing of glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. All God's people sing of glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns. All God's people sing of glory, glory, hallelujah, he reigns, he reigns. All God's children sing.
Well, it is so good to have people in the room instead of just this one big eyeball staring at me during the service. So I am so happy that you folks are back with us, and just trusting that as God continues to bring health and just safety to our community, we'll be able to continue to welcome more and more people back into our room as time goes on. We know that there are still people that, because of health concerns or being in a high-risk group, are not comfortable in coming back, and we completely understand that. We are fine with that. We want your health to be taken care of. But again, we're trusting that in time we'll be able to just continually welcome more and more people back into our facility. So for those of you here today, we are delighted. Those of you online, we are glad that you're continuing to join us in that way. You know, we all make choices in life, don't we? You made a choice when you came to Hope this morning. First of all, you chose to even come this morning or to log on and to be part of us. When you got here, you had to choose, am I going to sit inside? Am I going to sit outside? There are choices that we make all day long. What shirt am I going to wear today? What am I going to have for breakfast? And, you know, these are choices. And some of the choices that we make are pretty mundane. They are insignificant. But then we also make some that are incredibly important and monumental to our lives. Some choices, again, are maybe just very simple. You know, what will I put on? What will I eat? And we really give very little regard to those choices. Others, again, are much more important. Yeah, for some of you, it's where will I go to school? What career path will I pursue? Who will I marry? Where will I live? And there are decisions that we make, choices that we make that affect and change our very lives. And so as you can see, most of the decisions that we make, you know, what will I wear? What will I put on? What will I eat? They're soon forgotten. But there are choices that we make, and you can probably go back and find the place, find the chair, find the room that you were in when you made an important decision in life. I could take you to the place where I asked Georgia to marry me. I could take you to the place where I sat her down and told her that I believe God had called me to ministry, knowing that her parents had told her, never marry a pastor. And I went into that meeting with fear and trepidation. There are moments in my life when I made decisions, when I made choices that were so big that they changed who I am. And I know that's true for many of you as well. These life-changing decisions, choices, are significant. It was at this point in Jesus' teaching in the Sermon on the Mount that we've been studying for several months now, that he lays before the listener a life-changing decision. You may recall when Jesus started the Sermon on the Mount, he started with an appeal for the people to come to salvation. Several months ago when we started the sermon, we said his very first words were, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." We thought, why isn't that interesting? You would think Jesus would say, "Blessed are the rich in spirit." But he said, no, the poor in spirit, because people needed to realize that in and of themselves, they were spiritually bankrupt. They had nothing to offer. And it was only through the goodness, through the blessings, through the richness of God that these people could one day have the hope of heaven. And so he begins his message talking about the need of every heart, that people would come to a point of salvation. And as he works his way through this sermon, he is continually presenting them with choices. He'll oftentimes say something like, "Well, you have heard it said, but then I say." And in essence, what he is declaring to the people, there's a choice here for you. Now, you can do it the way of the world. You can do it the way of the religious leaders. You can do it the way of the Pharisees. Or you can do it the way that I am appealing to you to do today. And the Sermon on the Mount then has been full of choices that each and every one of us, I think, need to grapple with. We don't want to just read this and say, what a beautiful message. Boy, that Jesus was eloquent. Man, what a teacher. I took graduate level classes in education where we studied the Sermon on the Mount. Not for the content, but just the teaching style, the technique, the pedagogy that Jesus would use as he would unfold his truth. And yeah, you can look at it that way. Or you can choose to go deeper and say, what is he asking me to do? And so then, at this point in his sermon, he's beginning to culminate, to wrap up, to conclude his teaching. And so again, he appeals to people to make a choice. And he appeals to them to make the most important choice in life. The crowd on the hillside that day, I'm sure that many of them contemplated his question, his proposal, and many of them chose life. There are people maybe in this room, people sitting outdoors, maybe people online or who will even listen to this message later. Still have to grapple with that same question. What will I do with this Jesus? What will I do with the words of life that he brings? And so I feel that before we go in any further, we need to ask God to be at work within us. You know, oftentimes we don't pray in the middle of a message, but I want to ask you to do that with me now. And the reason is, I believe that there's a choice that you need to make. Now, many of you I know and I trust have made this decision years ago. But I don't want to be so naive or so foolish to think that everybody in this room's decided or that everybody who is listening today has already made their mind up as well. I know that many people are still grappling with the choices of life. And so I'm praying that not so much through Kevin, but certainly through the words of Jesus today, you'll be able to contemplate this, I think, most important decision in life. So would you pray with me? Father, there are decisions that we each one, every one of us make every day. And again, there are many decisions that we make that we today who are still considering. There may be some who have even heard his message before and have decided, no, I'm not going to go the way of Jesus. But Lord, I'm praying that today, maybe as they contemplate, as they think through this again, that there could be a change of mind, a change of heart, a change of life. And so I pray, God, that you would use me. I pray that you would use your word to help us to see the choice that is made in life. And so we commit these next few moments to you and ask God for your spirit to be at work within us. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. And in his teaching, then, Jesus poses, again, what I'm going to call a choice for people to make. And it's in Matthew chapter 7, verses 13 and 14, where he simply says, "Enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate that, and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go by it. Because narrow is the gate, and difficult is the way that leads to life, and there are few who find it." God has given people a choice to follow him. He has done this historically. He has done this throughout the ages. And he's always done this as a demonstration of his love for people. You see, if you're in a relationship with somebody, you give them the freedom to make up their mind. You don't force them. You don't coerce them. You don't compel them to always look at things your way. I think Jesus and God the Father are so much this way. You see, because of their love for mankind, they give us this opportunity, free will, if you will, this opportunity, this ability to make choices. And so this choice is to be in a relationship with him or not. Some people obviously have said yes to the offer, and there are, again, those who have said no. And I think this is very gracious of God in his character to be one who would extend the invitation, but again, not force you, compel you, coerce you into a relationship, because again, that would not be love. The choice, it's yours. It always has been, and it is today. God gave this choice to the people of Israel as well. When they had left Egypt and spent this time of wandering in the wilderness before they entered into the Holy Land, the Lord instructed Moses to tell the people of Israel. And in Deuteronomy chapter 13, verses 19 and 20, God speaking here, he says, "I call heaven and earth to be a witness against you today that I have set before you both life and death. I have set before you blessing and curse. So choose life in order that you may live and that you and your descendants may prosper. I do this as a loving God, and I ask you to obey my voice and to hold fast to me." You see, the people of Israel had been exposed to the gods of Egypt. Before they conquered Canaan, they had been exposed to the gods of the Canaanites and even the Amorites, and they had seen other gods. And so as Israel flees Egypt, and as they come into this time of wandering, they have choices to make. They'd observed, again, the different gods that had been worshipped and the practice of different people around them. And in their wanderings, and even before their conquest, they were exposed to many different gods in that area. And so Joshua one day calls the people of Israel together. And in Joshua chapter 24, verses 13 through 15, Joshua poses a question to all of Israel. He says, "You live in cities today that you did not build. You eat from crops that you did not plant. But now there's a choice that is yours. Whom will you worship?" You see, the people of Israel, they thought, look at all the abundance, look at all the blessing, and they knew that their hearts had wandered, and so Joshua realized they needed to come to a point in their life where they decided, will we bow our heads to the other gods, or will we worship the true God? And before anyone in Israel could answer, a verse that I'm sure most of you know, some of you probably have this up in your home, in your family room, have it in your kitchen, on your refrigerator, but in Joshua 24, verse 15, Joshua, after he poses the question to all of Israel, he answers and he says, "But for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." I don't know if you ever thought about why Joshua made that statement, but it's because he knew there was a choice that had to be made. And as the leader of the people of Israel, he wanted to model, he wanted to demonstrate that he too would make a choice to follow God. In 1 Kings chapter 18, there's a power encounter, if you will, between Elijah and the prophets of Baal and Ashtaroth. And they have determined before they go into this day that whoever God demonstrates power in this day, will be the God that Israel worships. And so I always like to say that Joshua is the consummate gentleman. He allows the prophets of Baal and Asheroth to go first. They each build their own altar. They each put the fatted calf upon it and slay it. And then Joshua allows the prophets of Baal and Asheroth to ask their gods to consume the altar. They cry out. They pray. They literally practice self-mutilation to show their gods how serious they are. And for 12 hours, their God does not answer. I love Joshua, or excuse me, Elijah. And he, I think, has a little bit of sarcasm like Kevin. And he kind of sits back and looks at these false prophets. And he says, hey, maybe your God's hard of hearing if you're just a little bit louder. Hey, maybe he's on a trip and you just need to get his attention. And their God does not answer. And then Elijah cries out and says, God, would you consume this altar and demonstrate today that you are God and God alone? And fire falls and consumes the altar. And then Elijah says these words, if the Lord is God, then follow him. And if not, follow others. You see, the people of Israel needed to make a choice. That's why Jeremiah said, choose for yourself today whom you will serve. God's offer for a relationship, again, it's never forced upon us, but it's always with the interest, the best interest of the individual at heart. Jesus was gracious in this way as well. Early in his ministry, there were those who were curious. There were those who were intrigued by this man from Nazareth, this man who had performed miracles, this man who had taught like none other. And so there were crowds that followed him, that flocked around him, and people wanted to, I think, just kind of see the show, see the wow, and they were following Jesus. And then he asks them some very pointed questions. And in John chapter 6, verses 66 through 69, it says this, that from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. You see, when they were given the choice to follow Jesus or to return to their homes, to return to their life that was without God, far and distant from him, as hard as it is to believe, many people that day chose to leave Jesus and return to their old life. Jesus then looked to his disciples, to the 12, and he says, do you not also want to go away? And Peter answered, said, Lord, where shall we go? You have the words of life. You are the Christ. You are the Son of God. You are the Messiah. There was a choice that many people made that day to reject Jesus. The disciples, and I'm sure a handful of others, decided to stay with him, to follow him, to heed his words. But it wasn't true of everyone that Jesus ever met. In Matthew chapter 19, we have the story of the rich young ruler, this man who wanted eternal life, and Jesus told him what he must do to have life eternal. And Scripture says that this man became sad. His countenance dropped because it was much too great a price that Jesus had asked of him. He turned his back on Jesus and walked away. You see, it takes effort to follow Jesus. It takes purpose of heart. It takes perseverance to walk with him. And there are those who made that decision, some in this room, some outside, some listening today, and there are many, many who have decided to no longer follow Jesus, to reject him and not to pursue him any longer. And so when Jesus gets to this portion of the sermon, he is helping people to see there's a choice that is to be made. When he says you are to enter by the narrow gate, I don't know if you've ever thought about this, but that is a command, narrow gate. In John chapter 10, we have this great teaching from Jesus again where he refers to himself as the good shepherd. And in that passage later, in, I believe it's verse 28, he says, I am the good shepherd. But building on that metaphor, earlier on in that chapter, he said something very interesting. In John chapter 10, verse 9, Jesus said, I am the gate. So now when he tells people to enter by the narrow gate, maybe it's starting to make a little more sense what he's asking us to do, to enter into life with him. A shepherd's gate was very interesting. If you've ever been to Israel, maybe you've seen pictures, it's not a land of lush forests. There's not a lot of trees and a lot of rocks. And so when shepherds would take their sheep out into the hills to graze, they couldn't build a corral out of wood to keep them at night. They would build stone fences. And they would build a corral in the shape of, the best shape I can explain it to you, would be that of like a horseshoe. A big ellipse, but there would be an opening. And they would drive the sheep into this corral, and then at night, to keep the sheep inside, the shepherd would lay down across that opening, and he would literally be the gate. He would be the last line of defense before anything could come in and attack the sheep, maul the sheep, harm the sheep. The shepherd put his life on the line. And he would do that by taking on the role of the gate of the corral. When Jesus says, I am the gate, he is our protection. He is our line of defense. And today he wants to welcome you into his flock, into his household, into his body, and be that one who preserves and protects you. Jesus is the gate, and he wants us to enter in through him. And this is why I believe in John chapter 14, verse 6, Jesus says, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. I want to break that down for you just a second here, where Jesus is saying he is, first of all, the way. He is the way to God. He's the way to eternal life. He's the way to the Father. He's the way to, I believe, purpose and fulfillment and gratification in life. He is the truth. There are many different groups that espouse truth, but their truth falls short and it fails. And there's only one absolute truth on this world, and that is Jesus and his proclamation of truth. And because of that, he too is the life. He is the one who brings and gives eternal life to those who say yes to the offer that has been extended to us. In Matthew chapter 16, verses 24 and 25, it says, then Jesus said to his disciples, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. It's costly. There's a great price in following Jesus. And when we enter in by that gate, we enter into life with Jesus. For again, he is the way, the truth, the life. And then Jesus tells us that there are two different paths that people might traverse in life. The wide gate, it leads to destruction, and the narrow gate is that which, again, Jesus says is much harder to follow, but it leads to life. The wide path, it's easy. It's simply to just go the way of the world. Do what everyone else does. Don't give it much thought. Don't worry about what it's doing to you on the inside. Don't worry about any kind of a moral compass within, but just let the world dictate to you what to do, what to be. And so that wide gate is a compliance or an acquiescence to the ways of the world. The narrow path is a call to holiness. It's a call to righteousness. It's a call to godliness. The narrow path is a call to follow Christ himself. It's not easy. And that's why, again, if anyone comes after me, let him deny himself. Take up his cross and follow me. Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 13 says, you will seek me and find me, declares the Lord, when you search for me with all of your heart. You see, as we are on this path, we keep our eyes gazed and fixed upon the Lord Jesus himself. He is the one who leads the way, and we follow behind him. And we need to be very careful about being good followers of Christ. There's a difference between those who raise or rear sheep and those who raise or rear cattle. Cattle, you get behind them and you drive them, you push them, you coerce them, you force them to go. You drive cattle. But with sheep, you get out in front and the shepherd leads. And it's through his presence, it's through his voice, it's through his ministry, if I can say it that way, that the sheep willingly follow. And so Jesus is our shepherd. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. So we keep our eyes fixed and gazed upon him as he leads. And as we follow him in life, again, there are choices. Every day there are choices to deter from the path, to take a detour, or to take our eyes off of him. And that's the struggle of life. And I think each and every one of us understand exactly what I'm talking about, because each and every one of us have had moments when we have taken those detours, when we've not fixed our eyes upon him as we should, and we look at the things of the world, we look at what other people are doing, and we pursue the wrong, and then we realize the error of our ways. And then fortunately and graciously, he brings us back. All we like sheep have gone astray, Isaiah says. But Paul, in writing to the church at Ephesus, reminds us in this following of Christ, in this walk with him, he says in verse 15 of chapter 5, be careful how you walk. Be careful about your lifestyle. Be careful about your character. Be careful about the things that you do, because you are a demonstration of Christ to this world. When we call ourselves Christian, we are literally saying we are one like Christ. And when I examine my heart, oftentimes there are things that I have to acknowledge, this is not something Jesus would do. And I need to repent of that, and I need to come back and get on the path and be the man, be the pastor, the husband, the father, the friend that he calls me to be. But you see, as we go down these paths, we realize there are two very distinct and different destinations. There's a broad path Jesus talks about, and as we have seen, Jesus says it leads to destruction, and ultimately that leads to hell. And there is a narrow path, that of following Jesus. It leads to life, it leads to heaven. This is truly Jesus' plan for the soul of each and every man. He wants us to come to faith. In Jeremiah, he says, I have set before you both the way of life and of death, and the choice is yours. But we need to make the right choice. In helping the church at Rome to understand this, Paul talked to them, and in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, he says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. You see, when we do things in our own way, when we enter by the wrong gate, when we choose the wrong path, when we choose the wrong destination, we leave the path that leads to our destruction and ultimately hell. And these sins bring about death. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But fortunately, God has also provided for us the remedy for our sin. And while in Romans 6, he says in verse 23, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus. Each and every one of us have stumbled. Each and every one of us have failed. Each and every one of us have sinned. And in our own, each and every one of us is worthy of hell. I've heard people say, surely a loving God would not condemn someone to hell. Let me pose the question another way. Surely a righteous God would not allow sin in his presence. You see, God has provided a way to pay for the sin of mankind, for your sin. And he did this upon Calvary's cross, when Jesus willingly yielded his life, when Jesus sacrificed his life as a ransom for each and every one of us. It was a debt, Scripture says, it was so great you could not pay it. And so it took God willingly to come and to yield his life to pay a debt that I owed, that you owe, and pay that himself. Now the choice is, will I accept payment or not? I've heard people say, you know, maybe there was a great bill that you have, a great debt that you have, and it's certainly beyond your means, your wherewithal to be able to pay it. And then some benefactor comes in and says, I'll pay for them. And you can either say, I accept that, or in your pride and your arrogance say, I don't need your help, I don't want your money, and reject the payment. You still owe the debt. It's still due to your account. The choice is, will you accept somebody to step in to make payment for you or not? There is nothing that you can ever do to pay for the sin of your life. There is something that Christ himself has done to do so. And so this is why we say there are two destinations. There are two gates, two paths, two destinations. And there are two different people groups, if you will. These are the people who come to faith and accept Christ. They're the ones who enter by the narrow gate. They're the ones who go on this narrow path. They're the ones that have the destination of hope. There are a group of people also who enter in by a broad gate, by an easy gate, if you will. And that's a broad path, and it's one that most people travel. And it's a path that leads to death, and it leads to destruction. There are two groups of people. And I'm praying today that you'll make the choice to be one who follows and walks with Jesus as opposed to one who walks with the world. At the end of Jesus' ministry, he was helping his disciples to see how things would culminate at the end of time. And in Matthew chapter 25, he said something very profound, very interesting. And it's a little long, but I want you to listen carefully. Matthew 25, verses 31 through 46. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, and all the holy angels are with him, he will sit on his throne in glory. And all the nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them one from another, as a shepherd separates both the sheep and the goats. And he will set the sheep on his right hand, and he will set the goats to his left. Then the king will say to those on his right hand, to the sheep, come, you who are blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the very foundation of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, you gave me drink. I was a stranger, you took me in. I was naked, you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me. I was in prison, you came to me. And then the righteous will answer and say to him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you? When did we see you thirsty and give you drink? When were you a stranger to us and we took you in? When were you naked and we clothed you? Or when were you sick or in prison and we came to you? And then the king will answer and say to them, assuredly I say to you, inasmuch as you did it to one of these, the least of these, my brethren, you've done it to me. And then he will say to those on his left, to the goats, depart from me, you who are cursed, into the everlasting fire that has been prepared for the devil and all of his angels. For I was hungry, you gave me no food. I was thirsty, you gave me no drink. I was a stranger, and you did not take me in. I was naked, you did not clothe me. I was sick and in prison. You did not visit me. And then they will answer him saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and thirsty or a stranger or naked or sick or in prison? And we didn't minister to you. Then he will answer to them saying, assuredly, I say to you, inasmuch as you did not do it to the least of these, my brethren, you did not do it to me. And these will go away into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. The choice that we make about the gate that we go through, the path that we walk, the destination literally means the difference between heaven and hell. And there are those in our lives, there are those, I believe, even listening today, who have not accepted the payment of Jesus on Calvary's cross. And because of that, one day you will be separated from him. Just as he separates the sheep from the goats, you'll be put to a side where one day you'll be condemned to a Christless eternity. You'll be condemned to hell, to eternal punishment. It's not what Jesus wants. He says, all who are willing, come. And today, if you are willing, today could be the right moment for you to say yes to Jesus. And so we're going to close this time with a word of prayer. And if this prayer that I will utter is the prayer of your heart, just say it silently, quietly in your heart. And know that he is faithful to his promises. That if you enter in by that narrow gate, if you choose to walk that narrow path, you can choose the destination of your eternal soul. And that's the choice that is yours today. So, Father, thank you for the clear teachings of Jesus, that there is a choice set before each and every one of us for our eternal destiny. And today we have learned that there are, in fact, two different gates to choose. There's a broad gate that most in this world choose and go through. But there's a narrow gate that very few find and enter in. There's a broad path. It leads to destruction. And today we've seen just a glimpse of what that destruction is. It's a place of eternal punishment. It's hell. But there are those who walk a path that leads to you. They're welcomed into your eternal kingdom and into your eternal peace and joy and rest. And Lord, I believe there are those listening today that still need to make that decision. And so I pray that in their heart they might say something similar to this. Lord Jesus, today I understand that I have a choice to make. And I can choose the way of the world or I can choose the way of life. And I know that within me there's a spirit that is crying out for truth. And I believe today I have heard truth. I believe that in these decisions that I make, I can choose my eternal destiny. And today I want to reject hell. I want to reject that broad gate, that broad path. And I choose to enter into the narrow gate and to walk with you. I know it'll be hard. I know there will be changes asked of me. But I also believe that you give strength. And so today I want to say yes to Jesus. I want to thank him for dying for me on Calvary's cross. And because of that, I want to thank you for life eternal that is mine and the hope of heaven. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen. I want to ask you to do one thing. If you prayed that prayer or something very similar to that today, would you reach out to somebody and let them know? Would you maybe send me an email, send one of our elders an email or a text? Maybe the person next to you, just look over and say, I went in through the narrow gate today, and let them know. And then we will help you with that path, with that destination that is set before you. We'll come alongside you and be that strength, that support, that family that is so dearly needed with these decisions of life. I pray that you've made that decision today. I pray that you let us know. In these choices that we make, we choose to follow Jesus. And we choose to be obedient to his word. And in Scripture, he's also invited us to make a choice. To remember what he has done on Calvary's cross, or to kind of just go through life blindly and not really giving much thought or consideration. And so at Hope, we choose to be reminded of that and to remember that each week. And so each week we partake of communion. And communion reminds us of what Jesus did on Calvary's cross, that yielding of his body, the shedding of his blood as the payment for our sin. If you're here with us today, you were given a little cup like this. It has the elements of communion all wrapped together. And I want to help you with this. If you open up and get to the juice first, you've got a little trouble. Then it's really hard to get to the bread. But you may notice there are actually two seals. And the first one is a very thin cellophane seal. And if you peel that off, you can simply take the bread. And then you can peel the foil and get to the cup. I want to share that with you so that you didn't have to juggle this communion offering in your lap and maybe have a spill. So those of you at home, we trust that you've been doing this each week and you know how to do it there at your house. But I wanted to help the folks here within this room. But now we hold in our hand this small piece of bread that reminds us of the broken body of Jesus. And so God bless you as you partake now of this bread that reminds us of his broken body. And God, we also thank you for the cup that reminds us of his shed blood poured out for the remission of sin. And God bless you as you partake. Lord Jesus, we thank you for what you have accomplished on Calvary's cross, for that invitation to enter in by that narrow gate, to walk with you, and to live life eternal with you. We're reminded of that as we partake now of communion. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
Precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been set free. My God, my Savior has ransomed me, and like a flood, his mercy reigns unending.
we thank you so much for your Son. We thank you that through him you've provided a way for us to be reconciled to you, that we can enter through that narrow gate into eternal life with you. Help us, Father, to be mindful of how narrow that path is, and watch where we're putting our feet. Help us to walk in Christ's footsteps, to follow Christ and the example that he set for us in how he loved people and how he loved you. Pray these things, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, Kevin was talking about the sheep and the goats when we stand before Christ and we're separated by who chose to follow and who chose not to follow. And I found it interesting in the scripture when he's talking to the goats and tells, you know, that you saw me and you didn't feed me. Their response is, Lord, when did we? Lord. They will recognize that he is Lord then. Every knee will bow. And that day, his glory will be truly defined. I pray that those of us who have not accepted Christ will recognize that it is the most important choice that you'll ever make in your life. And that the right choice is the choice that leads to life. There's always a better way. There's always a bridge that needs crossing. There's always the straight and the narrow, the wide and the shallow. But I know that you're guiding me, that the best is yet to come. You've given me hope for tomorrow, and I know someday I'll wake up to over me. It's always in front of me. It helps me to remember that this is what I live for, and I can't wait till I wake up to find your glory defined, and I will finally bow at your feet. Oh, never a moment without your presence. There's never a doubt in my mind that I'll wake up to find your glory defined. I will finally bow at your feet. Oh, I will lift up your name in honor and praise when I cross over Jordan. And I wake up to find your glory defined, and I will finally bow at your feet. Oh, I will lift up your name in honor and praise when I cross over Jordan. I know that I'll be running home to you. I'll be running home to you. Amen. Amen. Oh, thank you for being here today. Those of you that came out in person, it's so awesome to see you all. I can't see your faces, but I can see your masks. Those of you joining us at home, thank you for tuning in. Just remember that Jesus loves us so much. And he knows that it's difficult to walk with him. And that's why his Spirit is with us, to guide, direct us, encourage us, and strengthen us, help us in every way. If we open our hearts and minds and let Christ guide us, then it's not quite as difficult, because he is with us and he promises to be with us every step of the way. Just a reminder, we have Bible studies on Zoom classes still on Monday nights for men's and women's Bible studies. Kevin, is it this Wednesday that you're doing the Thursday the 26th, Kevin will be doing a 25th, sorry. Kevin will be conducting a Zoom Bible translation course. There's so many different translations of the Bible to help you to understand the differences and which one is the one that will speak loudest to you in your journey with Christ. So that's it. Thank you so much for being here. We love you and look forward to seeing you again next Sunday. Hey? Yeah. Very good. One, two, three, four.